Chances are that you're coming here for the first time and you're wondering, what does this brand new sermon series mean? Well, we've been in the book of Ephesians over the last few weeks, and we've been learning about what it means to live in light of the truth that we have been made new by the blood of Jesus. And really, what we've been doing the last few weeks is talking about how that impacts us as individuals, right? And the decisions that we make. But as we continue on over these next few weeks, what Paul is going to do is he's going to sort of expand our horizons a bit, and he's going to point us to our relationships, right? How we're to live as brand new creations in our most important relationships. And the truth is, I think this might be the most important part of the conversation, because for most of us, we don't really know what it looks like to practically apply the gospel to our relationships. It's a lot easier for us to understand the difference between good and bad, or if you guys have been here with us, the difference between sort of the devil's playground and where we've been created to exist on the Lord's playground. Right, but when it comes to our relationships, it's different. And that is especially true when it comes to our most important earthly relationship, and that's the relationship that we have with our spouse. Right? And how do I know this? Well, the proof is in the pudding, right? Because honestly, the divorce rate among non-Christians is pretty much identical to the divorce rate among Christians. So clearly, we're not experiencing marriage the way that God intended it. And so what we've done instead is we've allowed culture to shape our marriages. We've allowed culture to shape our marriages, and we've allowed culture to tell us this lie. We believe the lie that our marriages are solely for our own fulfillment. We believe this lie that culture has told us, that our happily ever after has more to do with our here and now with our spouse than it does with Jesus for eternity. I know I'm coming in hot, but there's a reason why we need to understand this point. Right, that our identity and our belonging is not to be found in a soulmate, but it's to be found in our Savior. So let me ask you this, church. What if God designed marriage not to make you happy, but to make you holy? Let me say that again. What if God designed marriage not to make you happy, but to make you holy? What if he blessed you with your spouse not to fulfill all of your needs, but to point you to the only one who can? See, what happens when we allow culture to shape our marriages is we expect our spouse to fill the shoes that only God can fill. But when we allow our Creator to shape our marriage, we put our dependence on him rather than on our spouse, and we take the pressure off of our spouse, we take all of those expectations off of our spouse, and we can focus on the true intention for marriage, which is for each of us to become more and more like Jesus. Let me tell you, family, once you have experienced marriage the way that God intended it, you'll see things completely differently. All of a sudden, all those requests that your spouse makes that start to feel like nagging, they're going to look more like an opportunity for you to serve. Right? Or those arguments that you have that feel like this power struggle, well, now those are going to become opportunities for you to sacrifice. It changes everything. Right, because you're pursuing holiness rather than chasing some fleeting feeling of happiness. And the irony is, family, when you start to focus your marriage on holiness, you're probably going to be a lot happier. You guys see that? When you focus your marriage on holiness, you're going to be a lot happier. It seems counterintuitive, but when the focus becomes service and sacrifice, that power struggle gets eliminated. And instead, you and your spouse are empowered to operate in the roles that God has intended for your marriage. And that's when you're able, in your marriage, to truly reflect Jesus to the world. That right there is the goal for our marriages, right? To be founded in the truth of the gospel and to reflect Jesus to the world. That is what we're talking about this morning. That is what a brand new marriage looks like. Are y'all with me this morning? All right, we're going to keep rolling. Let's pray together, though. Father, I thank you for the gift of another day. Lord, where we can come together to worship you. Lord, I thank you for the ways that you are moving in your church, for the opportunities that you are giving us to go and to be the church for the community. But Lord, I want to pray this morning very specifically over the relationships, over the marriages in our church family. Lord, I know some of these marriages have come under attack recently. Lord, would you speak to the hearts of your children this morning? Would you reveal to your sons, reveal to your daughters the truth of who they are? And Lord, would their pursuit of holiness be what leads them to that happier and healthier marriage that puts you on display, Lord, for the world to see? So Lord, would you speak through your word this morning? Would you expose the lies that the enemy wants us to believe? Would you shine the light on your truth? I pray this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Well, we are going to be in Ephesians 5 this morning. So if you have your Bibles or your Bible apps, I want to encourage you to get those out. Find your spot there. And as you do, I want to just do a very brief recap of where we've been, where we left off last week. Paul's been giving us these instructions, again, for how we are to live these brand new lives in the midst of this broken world. And last week, he pointed us to the fact that we are going to be tempted to impersonate the world. But he called us, in Ephesians 5:1, to imitate God instead. And we talked at the end of the message about how intimidating that idea can be, that we are to imitate God. We in our brokenness are supposed to somehow imitate God. But then he points to this very simple but very powerful truth that we can only do this by the power of the Holy Spirit. Right? That even us having the desire alone, that comes from the Holy Spirit. We need that in order to fulfill these commands. And church, I want you to hold on to that truth this morning, because the commands we're going to talk about this morning might even be more difficult than the ones we talked about last week. And so it's only by the power of the Holy Spirit that we are going to even have the desire and the power to be able to do these things that Paul is going to instruct us to do. So if you have your Bibles or Bible apps, turn with me to Ephesians 5, beginning with verse 22. Wives, submit to your own husbands, as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of the water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle in any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. All right, I may not be a church historian, but my guess is that these verses that I just read have been ruffling feathers ever since they were first read aloud in the church in Ephesus. Because to be honest, no matter what the cultural context has been, no matter how things have shifted over the last 2,000 years, these commands have always been countercultural. These commands have always really been counter-human, because in our sinfulness, they go against everything our flesh desires. They stand in opposition to what we want. See, like in our sinfulness, we are hardwired to oppose these commandments to submit and to sacrifice. Kind of like the way that Native Texans are hardwired to oppose Californians, right? But the truth is, hold on, you Native Texans, that just like your new neighbors from California, of which I am one, these words can't be avoided, right? So we have to address them head on, right? So that's what we're going to do this morning, is we are going to understand together what these mean, this commandment for submission and for sacrifice. We're going to talk about what they mean, but we're also going to talk about what they don't mean, because the truth is that these words have been used as weapons. And then we're going to do what we always do, and we're going to make the spiritual practical. We're going to talk about how we are to live these things out. But church, I'd be remiss if I didn't first address the elephant in the room. Because I know that some of you are hearing these words, maybe for the first time, and wondering, why does God give wives different instructions than husbands? Right? Aren't we all created equal? Don't we all carry the same value and the same dignity as co-heirs with Christ? Well, the answer is undoubtedly yes. We have been created equal, but we've also been given different roles, different responsibilities, which is why God's word is clear that we are to show one another the same respect while at the same time recognizing our unique responsibilities as husband and wife. You guys with me on this? Okay. I want to try to illustrate this point for you a little bit better. So I'm going to do something I don't normally do, and I'm going to ask a couple of my friends up here to join me for a quick illustration. So would y'all put your hands together for Steve and Karen Delware? Now, to know Steve and Karen, come on over here, guys. To know Steve and Karen is to love Steve and Karen. These two are honestly two of the most incredible people that you'll ever meet. But if you know Steve and Karen, you also know that these are two of the most passionate and strong-willed people that you'll ever meet. Is that fair? Okay. And so, when God brings together two people like this, how are they, in their strong will and passion, supposed to operate within marriage? Well, he gives them roles to fill, right? And so what I want to do this morning to illustrate this point for you is I'm going to ask these two to dance. Like, no, seriously, I'm gonna ask them, not the A&M spring break style dance, I'm talking about like the at the wedding slow dance kind of dance, okay? And what I want you guys to see here is the role that each of them take. And so we're going to roll some music here in just a second. And Steve, I want to ask you to lead your wife in the dance. Karen, would you follow him as he leads you? We got some music queued up. Would you roll that? All right, that's good, that's good. Hey, that looked pretty good, right? These two have clearly done this before. See, when Steve operates as the leader and Karen follows, something beautiful happens. But let's see what happens when Karen tries to lead as well. So we're going to roll the music again in just a second. Steve, I want you to lead, but Karen, I want you to lead also. Okay? Let's roll the music. All right, not bad, not bad. Okay. Clearly not as easy and simple of a flow there. You guys can put your hands together for Karen and for Steve. You guys can see what happens when two people try to lead, right? That actually is pretty graceful. These two have been through a lot, and so I think they've learned how to sort of manage things, but you've seen it. When people try to lead together, they end up stepping on their toes, or sometimes even worse happens. But if both partners are complementing each other in the roles, right, that they have been assigned, well, something beautiful happens. And that same goes for your marriage, right? Karen taking on that role of following Steve is not her taking on a lesser role, but it's her doing her part to help her marriage flow beautifully. Right? And when Steve takes on the weight of that responsibility that comes with leading, it's not about elevating himself, it's about elevating his wife. Right? Normally in the dance, it's the one that follows that really is portraying the beauty of what's going on. So hopefully that helps illustrate that point for you a little bit, because the reality is, y'all, the hard truth is that both husband and wife are called to die to themselves. Right? See, for wives, the way that they're called to do that is through submission. And for husbands, the way that they are called to die to themselves is through sacrifice. Neither of those is easy. Neither comes naturally, but both, church, are necessary. So let's dive deeper into each of those commandments as we better understand what it means for wives to submit and for husbands to sacrifice. Look back with me, if you would, at Ephesians 5, beginning in verse 22. It says, "Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands." Now, we've got a lot to unpack there, but it all centers around one word, right? Submission. So we need to start by defining its true meaning, because the truth is, right, that culture has taken this word, it has shaped it, and it has used it for its own benefit. It's used for something completely different than what the Lord intended it. See, the actual Greek word that Paul uses here, the definition for submission means to be subject to. But it actually carries with it this connotation of willingly making yourself subject to someone else, right? Willingly placing yourself under someone else's authority. Kind of like we just watched Karen, right? Willingly being led by Steve, at least the first time, right? And this word, it's a Greek word, it's called hypotasso. You don't need to necessarily memorize that, but what I want to point out to you is that this is a word that sometimes is used for like military troops submitting to the authority of their leader, but it's also used a couple of times when referring to the way that Jesus submits. That's right, Jesus submits. So let me point out a couple of these instances because I think it's really interesting, really helpful for our conversation. Let's look at Luke 2, verse 51. After this scene where Mary and Joseph sort of accidentally leave Jesus at the temple, it says this, Luke 2, 51. "And he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was submissive to them." So Jesus was submissive to his earthly parents. But he was also submissive to the Father. Look at 1 Corinthians 15, 28. Words of Paul say, "When all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to him who put all things in subjection under him, that God may be all in all. So Jesus submits, or in other words, he voluntarily makes himself subject to both his earthly parents and the Father in heaven. And what he models for us is more than just an act of submission, but actually an attitude of submission. It's actually a posture of submission. And that leads me to my first point on the misconceptions of submission. So we've talked about the meanings of submission. Let's talk about some of the misconceptions. And misconception number one is that submission is only for women. That's a misconception that is simply not true. We all submit. We submit to our parents when we're little. We submit to the local authorities. We submit to church leadership and so on. Submitting to authority is part of how our world was created, how we are supposed to maintain order in this world. So the command here is not that women are the only ones who ever have to submit, right? Or even that any woman is supposed to submit to any man. The command here is specific for the marriage covenant, that the wife is to submit to the husband, which naturally leads to the next major misconception, might be the biggest misconception, is that submission implies inferiority. This might be the biggest misconception because, honestly, it's the biggest and most frequent objection that people have to this passage. The command to submit, though, doesn't mean that you are in any way lesser than your husband, or that you in any way lose your voice or can't think for yourself. That is a lie that has been shaped by culture. It's a lie that's been used by the enemy, and to be perfectly honest, unfortunately, it's a lie that has been used by even evil men in the church for their own benefit. But I want to be clear here. Submission that preaches inferiority is not submission at all. That is oppression. You guys hear that? Submission that preaches inferiority is actually oppression. These words are not to be twisted. This command is not to be forced, men. Wives, it is your responsibility, not your husband's right, so enter into it willingly from a place of confidence in who you are in Jesus. That leads me to the third misconception this morning, which is that submission requires blind obedience. Submission requires blind obedience, also just not true. I love what Pastor John Piper has to say about this. He says, submission never leaves the brain at the altar. Just because you're called to submit doesn't mean you're not supposed to ever express your thoughts or opinions. In fact, it's your responsibility to call things out, right? When your husband doesn't understand something, when he can't see something, it's your responsibility to call those out. Lindsay does that with me all the time. Because all the time there are things that I don't see or that I don't understand, but she brings those things to me in a respectful and a kind and loving and a gracious way. She doesn't blindly follow me, and I wouldn't want her to blindly follow me either. She speaks up for herself, but again, with kindness and respect. So remember, wives, the expectation is not that you would follow blindly, but that you would submit willingly. Okay, we've talked about the meaning of submission. We've talked about the misconceptions around submission. Now let's talk about the model that we've been given for submission. How wives are to live this out. Verse 24 says, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. So in the same way that we give ourselves fully to Jesus, wives are to give themselves all-inclusive and unconditional the submission to their husbands. Now again, I know that's going to ruffle some feathers. So let me explain to you what I mean here. Your submission to your husband is not conditional on whether or not you like him in the moment. Right? Your submission to your husband is not conditional on whether he's holding up his end of the bargain. Right? When you accept the invitation to dance like we saw up here, that's not conditional on whether or not your husband is going to be light on his feet. No, you've committed to marriage. You've committed to a covenant. And with that commitment comes the commitment to submit. As long as he's not putting you in harm's way, as long as he's not leading you into sin, you're called to submit to him just as the church submits to Christ. That's hard, right? But that's what it looks like to die to yourself. And I know Paul doesn't give us any practical examples here necessarily of what that looks like. And so I thought, how can I share this with the wives here? What does it look like for us as a church to submit to Christ? What are some ways that wives can model that? Well, first, here's one way you can do that. You can trust your husband and show him that you trust him. Tell him that you trust him. Second, be ready to listen when he's ready to talk, and be willing to accept it when he's not. Does that make sense? Be ready to listen when he's willing to talk and be willing to accept it when he's not. And third, honor him. Honor him. He may not always deserve it, but you can still choose to honor and respect him. Don't badmouth him to your friends, but honor him, not just with your words, but with your thoughts. Because remember, submission is more than an act. It is an attitude. And wives, what will happen when you adopt this attitude? When you press into the true meaning of submission and let go of all of those misconceptions, is you'll find yourself interested more in holiness than in happiness. And you'll find that your marriage is reflecting Jesus to the world. Sound good, wives? Okay. All right, we're going to shift a little bit over to the men in the room. Wives, you are not off the hook. I want you to stay engaged this morning, but we're going to shift our attention over to the fellows as we talk about the meaning and misconceptions for sacrifice. And of course, we'll look to the model about how we are to live that out. So look with me, if you would, at Ephesians 5, verse 25. It says, "Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her." Okay, fellas, it doesn't get much more simple than that, right? Love your wives, lay down your lives for them. So if it's that simple, then why is it so hard? Well, again, it goes against everything our flesh desires, like we talked about earlier. But just like with submission, we've been led to believe certain lies about what sacrifice is supposed to look like, or really what even sacrifice is. So let's look again at the meaning of sacrifice to help better understand it. See, Paul uses the example of Jesus to define sacrifice, and the connotation here is really similar to that of submission. Remember, submission was willingly making yourself subject to somebody else. And this idea of sacrifice, especially the reference he's making here, is that sacrifice is willingly handing something over of value to someone else. And that's exactly what Jesus did, right? He handed himself over to be betrayed and beaten and crucified so that we might have life with him. So that's both the definition and the standard by which we are called to sacrifice on behalf of our wives. In other words, to be a leader in our marriages, the expectation, gentlemen, the expectation is that you would be ready to serve and willing to suffer on behalf of your wives. Ready to serve and willing to suffer. All of a sudden, that leadership role doesn't sound so sexy now, does it? Honestly, if you really stop to think about what it means to sacrifice for your wife, you'll realize this is more than just being sensitive, maybe stopping at HEB to pick up some flowers on the way home, right? Because as C.S. Lewis puts it, the husband who embodies this verse is the one whose marriage most feels like a crucifixion. Whew. Man. I see a bunch of husbands in here who are like, "I'll take submission, please." Right? C.S. Lewis dropping the hammer. But see, that's the posture that we as husbands, that we get to take. I know it feels like a burden, but it is an opportunity. It is a blessing that we get to take this posture. That right there is the attitude that's necessary for us to lead as Christ has called us to lead. The reality is that we have been called to die to ourselves just like our wives have. For them, that looks like submission. For us, that looks like sacrifice. But I want to remind you, both husbands and wives, that you're not in this alone. Right? That is the Holy Spirit who gives us the desire and the power to do these things in the first place. So by the power of the Holy Spirit, right, that's the way we are to have this true Christ-like leadership in our marriages. That's not elevating ourselves, but elevating our spouses. That's what it means to sacrifice for them. So let's talk about some misconceptions about sacrifice. In my mind, there are really two major misconceptions when it comes to our view of sacrifice. The first is that sacrifice must be earned. Sacrifice must be earned. That is a misconception. Our wives don't have to earn the sacrifice that we have been called to self-initiate. Could you imagine if we had to earn the sacrifice of Jesus? We would all be condemned to hell. I mean, right? We wouldn't even be able to begin that conversation. Instead, right, the example of Jesus proves to us that true sacrifice doesn't need to be earned or deserved or even requested. Right, Jesus sacrificed for us out of his love. Romans 5:8 reminds us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So guys, stop tallying the marks on whether or not your wife deserves your sacrifice. Be more like Jesus and sacrifice for her even if she's not deserving of it. Let me encourage you too, don't hold back, right? The word doesn't tell us that there is any limit on the frequency or the intensity of the sacrifice that we've been called to give for our wives. You have been given authority in marriage, and with that authority comes the expectation that you will always be ready to serve, that you will always be willing to suffer on behalf of your spouse. So misconception number one is that sacrifice must be earned. Misconception number two is that sacrifice earns you the right. See, as husbands, maybe I'm alone here, but I'm guessing I'm not. When you sacrifice for your wife, you tend to go kind of give yourself one of those gold stars like on the kindergarten behavior chart, right? I know I'm not the only one. Guys, you come home from work. It's a long, hard day at work, and man, I sacrificed for my family today, gold star. Right, you go out like I did yesterday, 115 degrees, and you're mowing the lawn. You come in, and it's like, hey, you know what? Gold star. Well, first of all, guys, that's not a sacrifice. Your job and your home, that's your responsibility. So let's just start there. Let's be honest with ourselves. But regardless of how or when or why you are sacrificing, it doesn't matter. Because your sacrifice should come from a place of willingness, of willing. Being willing to hand yourself over without expectation of receiving anything in return. So I hate to burst your bubble, guys, but your sacrifice doesn't earn you the right to do whatever you want. It doesn't. So stop thinking about what you deserve and start coming home ready to serve. Stop thinking about what you deserve. Come home ready to serve. That is real sacrifice, right? Walking in the door after a long, hard day at work, not ready to be served, but to serve. That sounds familiar to you. That's what Jesus did for us, right? He didn't come to be served, but to serve. And now he's calling you to do the same for your bride. Listen, guys, I know this doesn't come naturally. I know from personal experience, but it's necessary. The only right that sacrifice gives you is the right to continually lay down your life for your wife. Okay, we're almost to the end of our passage for the day. Let's look at how God calls us to live this out now. Look with me at verses 28 through 30. It says, in the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. No one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. Now, it's almost like Paul knew how simple guys are, maybe because he was one. So he makes it as straightforward as possible and says, guys, in the same way you love yourself, love your wife. Right? Love your wife as you love your own body. Whatever you would do for your own body, the way that you feed it, the way that you take care of it, the way you work out, whatever you do, do that for your spouse. And then he uses these two words. He says, nourish her and cherish her. Now, I know most of the guys in this room, it's not in your normal vocabulary to use the words nourish or cherish. And so what I want to do is I want to explain what these two words mean, because I think it's going to give you some really practical help on how you are to live this out. See, the simple definition for nourishing something is to provide what's necessary for health and for growth. Provide what's necessary for health and growth. So think about this with your body, right? You feed yourself, you work out, you do these things that are necessary to help you grow. And that's exactly what's expected of you as a husband, that you would sacrifice your time and your attention to provide for her. Not just in the tangible ways, but more importantly, in the spiritual ways. It's not enough to work hard to provide for her. Guys, you need to be reading your Bible with your wife. You need to be praying with her, going to church with her, sitting at life group together. In the same way you make sure your own body is fed and taken care of, don't neglect your spouse. Don't neglect her soul. See, that's what it means to nourish your wife. Now, what about cherishing her? See, to cherish your wife is to protect and to care for her in a loving way. Again, the responsibility here is more about the spiritual protection. I know that's not what we tend to think of as husbands, right? We tend to think of actually physical protection. But the fact is, right, that we are living in a spiritual world. And there is a spiritual war going on out there. So the best way for you to protect your wife is to pray for your wife. I'm going to say that again. I'm going to look all you guys in the eye, right? The best way to protect your wife is to pray for your wife. How many of us are actually praying for our wives? How many of us are actually fighting the battle for our wives on our knees? Guys, that's where it has to start. The battle begins on our knees as we pray for our wives. We pray for her just like Jesus prayed for us before he laid down his life for us. That is our model. Pray for your wives. If you do nothing else, pray for your wife. I want to invite the band back up, and as I do, I want to just point us back to the goal for our marriages like we talked about earlier. this brand new marriage, right, that is founded in the truth of the gospel that reflects Jesus to the world. Let me ask you, husbands and wives, do you want that? Thank you. Do you truly want that? You don't have to answer this next one out loud, but do you have that? Some honesty in the back. I like that. See, the good news is this morning, that no matter where you find yourself, no matter what shape your marriage is in, that there is hope. Because the God of the universe longs to redeem your marriage and to use it to bring him glory, to point others to Jesus, to reflect his goodness and his grace to the world. So take comfort, friends, because there is hope and there is healing on the horizon. See, I think God in his grace is revealing some things to you this morning. I think he's revealing some ways that you maybe haven't submitted to your husband, wives. Husbands, I think he's revealing some ways that you have not sacrificed for your wife. I'm not saying these things to bring you shame, but to point you towards the hope. That when we do submit, when we do sacrifice, those are the building blocks that we place on a foundation that is the truth of the gospel that help us build that brand new marriage. So can I encourage you this morning, commit to your role. Now that you understand it, would you commit to it? Would you respect your spouse? Pray together. Read the word together. Live into these roles that God has called you to, and you will experience the joy of a brand new marriage.